KUHNFU leader. Thank you very much for coming and making this possible. Let's start with the first question. So you are the band leader. You're from Germany. You moved to Austria, Vienna. Is that true? So you also have Swiss roots. Is that true?
No, I used to live in Switzerland. I did my master's in composition in Switzerland. Should I do this?
No, harder.
Louder.
Sound-wise.
Okay. No, I used to live in Switzerland for 2 years. I did my master's in composition there, and then I didn't have a permit anymore because it's not Europe. And then I thought, okay, where to go? And I went to Vienna just for a change.
Okay.
But yeah. I'm not so settled, let's put it this way.
How do you feel it there, to be there?
It was a nice time. Did a lot of culture there. I visited a lot of concerts, theater. But I'm not settled at the moment at all. So
okay.
I have a little chair, a little table, and a guitar, and then let's see what the future brings.
Okay. So let's talk about KUHNFU. What does it mean to you? How did start.
It came out of a joke. Should I tell the real story?
Okay. Yes, of course.
Thanks to Facebook, I did a silly post once. Because my name, Kuhn, my name is Kühn, but in Holland nobody could say Kühn, so they said Kuhn. And it was a dumb Facebook post. I said King Kuhn, and then everybody came up with a name underneath. And an Italian friend came up with KUHNFU, and I thought that is a great band name. And it's my name in there, so it's my ego feels good with it.
Okay.
But
there's
it's more a silly name.
Is there no connection with?
There's
fighting?
No connection. I could find, and then I looked up KUHNFU, and it looked like. It's something you need a lot of practice to do and patience. And I said, wow, that's like music. But actually, it's all bullshit.
It's all bullshit.
It was just a dumb Facebook post.
Yeah. And what is the energy about KUHNFU? Can you describe that?
Well, we are young and middle-aged persons who like to play music in a very energetic way, I think. And that's what you... What was the question again? Sorry, I'm a bit lost.
The energy of KUHNFU.
The energy of KUHNFU. The life energy.
I mean, you know about the energy.
Yeah.
Because you
play
together, you travel together, you spend a lot of time together. So what's the interesting energy of KUHNFU?
I think the different characters. They're all four very strong characters. Now I'm sitting also, and though I'm writing the music, the music is really the four characters. We come from different countries that are also culturally apart. We have Turkey, Israel, Germany and Serbia, which doesn't make it always easy, but for sure interesting, and each one brings really his character into the band. So, for example, my writing is one part of it, but it's really just one part of it.
Well, you studied at the Prince Claus Conservatorium here in Groningen, and you graduated in 2000 and...
Wow, not so long ago. 13. I started quite late,
You graduated with guitar, right?
With guitar, jazz guitar.
Jazz guitar. Okay.
I don't know how I did that, but it was jazz guitar, yeah.
Okay. Can you tell me what you learned there the most and what...
Playing life.
And what you still use?
Playing life. I remember the first day the head of the school said, if you practice these 8 hours a day but you don't play life, it's useless. And at that time I was not playing. I mean, I came new, but I always had a problem with playing life because I was too nervous. And I had really bad experiences playing life.
Okay.
And in that school it was really about playing life. About playing. It was not so much about the artistic stuff that I got later to know, but it was about knowing your instrument, being able to play in different settings and play with students. I mean, there were every day people were playing, jamming, concerts, jam sessions.
Mm-hmm.
And that really took this nervousness for me. And now I love to play. I don't want to miss it.
Mm-hmm.
But if I had not done that, I would be still in the same condition. And I remember that had quite an effect on me when the head of the school, Joris, said that in his speech. That was a good thing to say. And I think it had on all. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, sure.
You had special teachers you loved?
For me, important was very the arranging teacher. Kurt Weiss was the arranging teacher because he really fostered that. You know, I was writing music in a very simple, but he really seemed to acknowledge that and let me do it. You know, had a big band, want to write a big band piece, want to arrange, here's something you can arrange for, which I really liked. And my guitar teachers for sure also. I mean, they were actually all good teachers. But for me especially, I must say that the arranging I really enjoyed.
And when did it happen for you that you were thinking about having your own band, your own quartet?
Always. Since I was a child.
Okay.
That's
so you waited for the big moment to ask these guys?
Yeah, I thought they are quite ugly. And no, they're not, but they're at the same status as me, you know, they're a bit. Some people need a band, I think. Some not.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely need a band. I'm not the solo artist. So for, I mean, that's really, I enjoy it with like-minded people to do this.
Can you tell me what kind of famous and also unknown influences you have at the moment running in your
life? At the moment? Oh, yeah, lately? Let's put it this way. When I started this band, I was heavily into Duke Ellington. Then I moved more listening to classical music, and now it's more contemporary music I like.
Can you tell some names so that
at the moment I really like
Bartok?
Bartok is not so contemporary, but Bartok I really like, and Georg Friedrich Haas, which is an Austrian composer. I just got to know through concerts. I saw concerts that I really like. Very important for me was Duke Ellington. As a child, the Beatles. That was probably also because I wanted to have a band. That was my first real music that I loved, was the Beatles.
Mm-hmm.
When I was a little child, I got a live record from them, and I really liked that. And other than that, the rock classics, for sure. I mean, after all, I'm an electric guitar player. So Led Zeppelin, like this stuff.
Okay.
And large ensembles. I like to listen to large ensembles. And with Kung Fu, I think we managed that also quite good. My aim is always that it sounds bigger than the four. And it's just four instruments.
Yeah.
And we try to achieve that through loudness sometimes, but it doesn't always. No, but then my ideal is the large ensemble somehow, the richness of a large ensemble. But that can change, maybe, but that I've been attracted to.
Yeah. Okay. Let's talk about your new album. It's called Kuhnspiracy.
Yeah.
Something like that. And you have a new label since this year.
Yeah.
That's right. And then I saw on your website something really interesting. You recorded analog in digital time, of course. In the Clouds Hill studio in Hamburg.
Yeah.
Then you mixed all in the Low Swing studio in Berlin. And you mastered everything in Amsterdam, at Amsterdam Mastering.
Quite a journey, yeah.
And then you also had interesting illustrations by this Vienna artist Arthur Bodenstein.
Yeah.
So now I want to have some stories to explain all that.
I'm obsessed with losers. I don't know what it is, but I really... not losers, but people who fail in life. And this when I wrote the music, like every song is about a person, kind of some guy climbing a mountain, not making it and dying, for example. And so we over the 2 years, we played a lot, I wrote the songs, we did that, and then it was time to record, and my financial, was quite good at that time. I was working in Switzerland in a hotel at night shift, and everything was good, and so we went to this analog recording, because I always wanted to record on tape, at least once in my life. Yeah, and then it was a journey. We had to mix it somewhere, so we looked for somebody who would have that sound, this analog, and that we can pay, and that just turned out to be Low Swing Studios.
But why you choose to record analog?
Well, if
for the looks of it to begin.
No. It's a sound. I mean, it's a different sound. It's
can
a
you
different sound.
It
has more depth. I mean, it's definitely. If you listen to old record, it sounds different than a new record.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's. And I just thought it would fit the sound of the band. We have kind of this classic rock sound. There's this influence. And it's also nice to record on tape because you don't have so many takes you can do. You cannot cut so easily. It comes from a different time, but it's valid still.
Mm-hmm.
The same with vinyl. Why do people now listen to vinyl all the time? Because it's just, it has more information. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But next time we might go for digital.
Okay.
It's just for this record we wanted that.
So this time it's a record, it's vinyl?
It will be released on vinyl, yeah.
Okay. And tell me something about this artist who made these illustrations.
Yeah,
please.
So I was in Vienna and I was looking for an illustrator to draw a picture that has all these characters that I talked about, these people who fail in life. And then from another band, Rom Scherer Eberle, he made the covers and I liked the style, and I met him in a cafe in Vienna, told him about it, he really liked the idea, and then we proceeded. And I think it worked out very well.
How was the atmosphere in this cafe, this Vienna cafe?
I don't know, but the guy is, Otto Bodenstein is, a peculiar character, also I would say. So it fitted really the my ideas and his drawing style. I think we really worked well together. Yeah, I'm happy we made it. It's as important as the music to me, the cover.
Mm. How do you live in Vienna? I mean, when I think back to my experience with Vienna, it's always based, it has something to do with this the third man situation,
know,
very old and these crazy people looking around the corner, old and...
It is old, that's for sure, it's an old
What's
city.
Going on now there in Vienna?
I mean, it's a cosmopolitan city. It's a European cosmopolitan city. It's a big city, but it has a morbid character. People are kind of, they're complaining, I mean, they like life, drinking, eating. And yeah, it's a good city to have a depression, I think.
And you have a depression there?
I had it when I came there. I had quite a bad depression, yeah, I must say. Not because of Vienna, just because of my life circumstances, but I overcame it. And that was also part of the record, like, it's when, I don't know. Yeah, it was not an easy time.
Mm-hmm.
But now I'm happy. We're going on tour.
Yeah, let's talk about leading a band. What do you have in common with James Last or Duke Ellington?
In common?
In common,
I don't know.
Of course.
I don't know.
I remember you had a song title.
Yeah, the dark side of James
Last.
Yes,
exactly.
Well, James Last, I don't know. I don't know really his music. I just. Yeah, it came out of a joke also when I had my composition class, my English teacher, Django Bates, he was, he heard a melody of mine and he was laughing. I said, "What is it?" And he said, "It sounds like James Last." So I said, and because it was quite a dark song, I said, "So the dark side of James Last," and then it came the song. But what I have in common with band is, I don't know, maybe the will to make a band happen, to be able to finance it.
But how much do you lead the band? Can you tell me about that? I mean,
how much do
are you running the band, and in which way do you influence the compositions, that it has to be your composition, they have to play it
yeah,
your
mean,
way?
Yeah, I mean, I started the project, so I write the music, but as I said, that's my part. I mean, you lead the band, but you also need the others. I mean, it's like on a football team, you need a coach, but you need the players. It's just my part, I don't know. It's not so important. For me, it is important, but in the overall picture, I think the band doesn't... If somebody would leave the band, I think the band would not... it's KUHNFU, you know? There's nobody's exchangeable.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
Well, your band is very international, and
yeah,
of course it's very special, even from the instrumentation. What are their roots for you and their behavior? Can you please share some stories about Ziv's kosher love, Esat's Turkish kisses, Lav's in the air with Serbian dreams, and all those German hugs? I mean, even these hugs, I think they are more coming from Holland, right?
Yeah.
And not from Germany.
No.
And maybe more from France also and Russia. So can you explain a little bit the quality and the magic of your fellow musicians?
Well, first of all, they're sitting next to me now. I have to talk about them. So
yes,
please
do.
Good things.
Yeah. Good things. Only.
I will bring them back also. Is Lav still here?
No, he's not there. Maybe they should talk also.
Yeah.
So, should I tell a story about everyone?
Yeah.
So, I mean, Ziv is a 100% musician, I would say. It's really music is his life and food. And he's very particular about the food thing. I mean, sometimes I don't have to eat. I just, you know, I forget. And then I eat a lot, but for him, he really has his times where he has to eat. And he takes very precise care of it, which is good for our touring. So we always have good nutrition and we're in good health, so to say. But I have never met that in a person. Esat is he likes life very much, and he likes too much of everything. So if he drinks coffee, he drinks 17 coffees. If he plays a bass loud, it's very loud. It's everything is a lot, and that's also great for the band. For example, he does a lot of booking. And Lav is a kind of a... It's our genius, I would say, on the drums. He doesn't like to practice. He's very what's the word for that?
Moody.
Yeah, we call him sometimes a moody bitch behind his back. I know he's not here, so we can say that also. But I mean, he has a phenomenal energy and is a lovely guy. But sometimes he needs a kick in the ass. That's for sure. But we have patience.
Okay.
And we hope he has with us.
Yeah. What does it mean for you to be German at the moment?
For me?
Yes,
well,
for
it's
you.
Great. I mean, I can travel anywhere. All the damage Germany did to the world obviously didn't backfire now. I mean, everywhere a German goes, you're welcome. I don't know. I mean, I'm not proud to be German at all. I just happened to be born there. But I take all the advantages it gives me without hesitation. But I'm not thinking that, if there's a next life, I could be an aunt or small bird. I don't know. Small bird, that sounds stupid. I think...
you can be bird.
Small bird. No, no, no. I don't know anything, but I'm not proud of being German at all. That. It's, but I realize when I go somewhere, it's easy. I mean, some people have problems with their passport. They cannot go to their country. And we, for example, in our band, we have different nationalities. To England is a problem. Visa. Ziv comes from Israel, so Arabic countries don't work so good. And that's weird. We just want to play music. I mean, and we want to eat the food in different countries.
What do you like about the others, and what you
don't
like about?
Well, first of all, I like how they play. That's really when I write the music. I mean, I can really hear it how they would do it, and I really like that. Really fits fits my guitar how they play. What I don't like, it's more, I guess, what I don't like about myself when I'm around certain people.
And so what is that?
I get stressed very easily, and they have to cope with that. Sometimes, for example, when I bring new music and it doesn't work instantly, and I behave not so nice, so. But there's nothing I don't like about them. Sometimes I don't like myself at some certain moments. It's not about the others.
It's almost natural.
Yeah, if you're relaxed, I mean, you can get along with anybody.
Mm-hmm.
It's, but I have this in me, I know it. Maybe that's my German, to the German question. I'm quite German in that aspect.
I mean, it's, in a way, it's interesting for me. You are a German guy. You have your own group. You tour a lot. I didn't want to ask this question, but you are a German Führer, right? So you lead, really, in a way. That's this.
Well, I'm good in organizing.
Okay.
That's, I think I am, for sure. And that also goes, composition is a kind of organizing stuff.
Yeah.
And
write really for these.
Yeah, I write the scores out and as much, but what happens live, the best is when we leave that, when we leave what's written on the page.
Yeah.
But I think I'm good in organizing. I mean, also with the touring, as I mean, we do it together, but that is not a problem for me.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas being relaxed and being thoughtful, for example, that's a major problem for me.
Yeah.
But therefore I have them.
Okay, yeah. Can you tell me a little bit about your music? What is the music about? I mean, you have titles for the music, but you don't sing.
But I think the music is very, how we say in German, erzählend. What's the English? Storytelling kind of music. It has a plot. It's program music. It's a bit, that comes from the romantic music, so it's about something. For example, this guy climbing the mountain. So it's really, I think you can hear it, the story. And I also like to tell stories when I'm drawing.
How are you?
That's
okay.
And that, I think, is in the music also.
Okay.
It's not an intellectual music, for example, that's very just absolute music. Or a virtuosic music, where it's about the virtuosity. It's really about the storytelling.
Okay.
And
I will let you know in a minute.
Okay.
I think now also the new record, you have to really listen to it. Something is going on.
Love stories.
See, now what I hate about my bandmates. No. Where was I? No, the storytelling is definitely there, and I lost it. Too many beers yesterday.
Just you have some titles in mind,
no,
and,
yeah.
And tell a bit about the story.
This Eiger Nordwand, for example, the last song. I was living in Switzerland and I in Bern, and the Eiger Nordwand is a very prominent thing there. It was the last mountain, so to say, that was conquered in the Alps, and a lot of people died. And I made up the story of a German, Hans Schmitz, trying, and he's dying and not making it, and he also tries to climb it out of the wrong reasons, just to be famous, you know, to be the first one who does it, and he fails, you know, and it's, maybe it's a metaphor for myself, I don't know, maybe that mountain, you know, it's the music, or maybe. Lav once said, I think you are Hans Schmitz.
Okay. Well, can you tell me a bit about your tour? I mean, you tour always a lot. It's really packed. You play every night in a different place, even in different countries. So what's happening the next 4 or 6 weeks?
No, we always do 2 week tours. So it's 2 weeks. And we do that because we live apart. One is living in Serbia, I live in Vienna, they live in Holland. So if we meet, we have to play a lot. Just for one gig to meet, it makes no sense.
Yeah.
The flights have to be covered and everything. And we have a car, so that makes it possible.
And this car has a name, right?
Günther.
Yeah. And, but the last year or 2 years ago, you also had very packed tours.
Yeah, we like that. It's kind of this... We like to be on the road. It's really... I mean, also the music develops through playing live a lot. I mean, when you start the tour and the end of the tour, it's a different story. What's happening?
Yeah. And what's happening on tour? I mean, you are joining a lot of time in the bus and and the van. And can you share some stories maybe from tour?
There is the story about the blue light. I still like that. So we are in Brussels and we have this huge car and it's new for us. So also we're not so used to driving it, and we're in this huge city and it's stress, and we have to get to the gig, and now the European cities are really not made for cars inside, and especially not a big blue car, Günther. So we're there and we don't know where to go, and then he just crosses a red light and we scream and he says, don't worry, I saw it, it was blue. And obviously he can see colors a bit different, so... So now we know a blue light is a red light that one can cross when he doesn't know where he is. So that was a story. Another story is the Hotel Rudolf in Czech Republic. So we're in this village in Czech Republic, and the guy gives us the key. So you go to this hotel and it's called Hotel Rudolf. It's like a vampire name on it. And we come there and it's dead. It's really dead. And we open it and it's like weird smell already, and then we go into a room and
we got the keys to the front door.
And we go inside and we go into our rooms, and then I hear them scream, and no joke, we went into their room, it had a smell, a shit smell you cannot imagine, but they had the room now, so we don't know where that smell came from, but we're going there in a few days again, and we see what happened then.
Okay.
There was that.
Christian,
yes.
I would like to ask you how you are in private. What's going on when there's no music? You told me that you lived, that you worked as a hotel during the night shift.
I did the night shift now for 4 years.
But you were fired, right?
No, the hotel got sold and...
Oh.
So, but I don't want to do that anymore. I mean, I got a lot of stuff done at night, I must say, but I lived a weird life. I mean, even when I didn't work, you sleep, you don't go to bed before 6 o'clock or 7 in the morning.
Yeah.
And it's not healthy. But I got a lot of booking done there, and also studying scores of music, listening, and that was nice. But I mean, I've been done now the last 10 years non-musical jobs to support my music, which I had never a problem with, but yeah, I hope I don't have to do that so much anymore, and would be great to live a little bit of it at least.
Yeah.
So that's the goal now, and I have to get more into writing music maybe for other people. I want for theater, that would be a goal.
Mm-hmm.
I would really like to write
also
music for theater. Let's see. But as long as the band goes well, it's great. And I hope it evolves more.
Yeah, the hair is good. I think it's
my private life, what was the other question? That how
yeah.
is it besides music?
Yeah.
Well, it actually I have no girlfriend. I'm single. I live for the music.
Okay.
I mean, it's really I'm in a good psychological state when I write music. Then I'm the person I want to be. And when I don't do that, I can get depressed easily.
So,
I must say. So I really know I have to do this to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't mean, I mean, I also have to keep doing it then when it's not successful.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really an inner urge, writing music. That's, and it doesn't mean that what comes out is great or so, but I feel like I have to do it and I want to do it.
Do you have a vacation sometimes?
From doing music? I mean, I had the last year, for example, there was a long time where I didn't do that, music in that way, and that was not a good period, as I said before, I had a depression. So, yeah, there is no holiday really. but now is the goal to keep on working. But there's a lot of business to do. I mean, having a band, doing the booking, once you start writing emails, it's a job by itself.
Yeah.
You mentioned that you had a depression. Can you tell me maybe how you get out of it?
Well, being active, going to concerts, that was really becoming active again. It was like a, we say in Germany, lethargie,
maybe you can give an advice for people who are suffering from depression and need a little bit of
Mean, there's two kinds, I guess. Some is self-inflicted by being not doing what you want to do. That was my case.
Mm-hmm.
And some are outer circumstances that you cannot affect. That was not my case. Then I guess it's much more difficult. And then there's some people who just tend to get easily depressed. It's in my family. So I know, okay, if I'm lazy, it will come. Still, I'm sometimes lazy and it comes. You learn later. To get out of it, for me, really, seeing live concerts, really like good music that are really like, or art in any way that.
What kind
and
of
people
art?
And people people get you out of depression. That was that's
nice.
For sure.
Mm-hmm.
If you hang out with people that do you good, that invigorate your creativity,
mm-hmm.
That helps a lot, I think.
So KUHN FU is also helping you?
A lot, for sure.
It's pushing you a lot.
I'm the person, really, I'm, when we play live, and it's like yesterday, I'm the person I want to be. That's how I see myself, or I would like to see myself.
Mm-hmm. So then your life is in a perfect situation?
It really feels like it.
Okay. Yeah.
It's really that makes it all worth. I mean, all the work doing the booking and stuff,
mm-hmm.
and also that to not take it for granted and that it's important to you, and that's what I also mean with watching other people's concerts or theater. So you really feel they do it for the moment, and it's very important to them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really life. That something is important to you. That has a lot of energy.
Mm-hmm.
And this moment. That gets you out of this state of. People who have it know what I mean.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank
for
you very
being
much.
That open with me.
Thank you for coming and doing this.
And I wish you good luck with the tour, and I
Thank
hope
you.
To hear the all your new songs very soon.
Yeah,
and I hope to hear another the third CD maybe next year.
Yeah, we are working on it. I think it's we want to, I mean, not next year, it's a whole process, a record, but I think we go for every 2 years, a record is
a good
idea.
Or maybe we can see or hear you even to the next Jazz Feats tour.
I would love it, but it's not in our hands.
Yeah,
it's not in our hands. Whatever hands it
is, we will see in which hands it
is. We know which hands it is.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for watching. That was KUHNFU live in a nice talk with me in the studio of Zoltan Aks Photography. You all know him. We all love him. Thank you very much for watching. See you next time. Yeah.